everyone. Thank you for joining our last talk of the Neurodiversity and Disability Equality event. We have Elliott, Spaeth here today and myself. Today we're talking about inclusive practices for both neurodivergent staff and students. Elliott, would you like to introduce yourself?
Yep. Hi, I'm Elliott and I work in the Academic and Digital Development team. My role is helping other lecturers think about how to teach, especially new lecturers and especially in relation to inclusion. Shall I get the slides up with our details on whilst I'm introducing myself? Would that work? Cool. I'll just share my screen. There we go. And I am neurodivergent myself. I'm autistic and ADHD and also disabled and also trans. So lots of lived experience of these things.
So a little bit about myself. So I'm Leigh Abbott. I lead the neurodiversity project in NVLS. So I'm contracted to Institute of Cancer Sciences and School of Veterinary Medicine, but I liaise with people throughout the university, including Quality Diversity Unit and Disability Services and HR and everyone. So that's my role. I also self-identify as neurodivergent. I'm not diagnosed yet, but I suspect that I have ADHD and dyslexia. So that's my background.
Is there any more housekeeping stuff you need to say before we get started, Leigh?
No, just that this meeting is being recorded. It will be disseminated via YouTube as well, but everyone is kept anonymous, so that's why we don't have any cameras today. And we'll try our best to not name anyone within the chat if we're taking questions.
Great. Lovely. Let's get started then. So today we're going to be talking about inclusive practices for both students and staff. I think it's an area where there's really not very much out there to support us working with students and particularly working with staff. I've had a lot of people mention that, and that's something Leigh's been working on in particular. So just a really quick introduction for those of you that aren't familiar. Neurodiversity is a term we're using quite a lot these days, but basically it refers to the idea that we all think, learn, process information, emotions, etc. in different ways, and that there isn't one best way of learning or thinking. And we sometimes use the word neurotypical to refer to the way that society makes it seem like one is meant to process information, and neurodivergent as a way of referring to the concept that some people's brains just don't really work like that. And it's a lot more nuanced than that, but those are the words that we have at the moment. So some examples of conditions that you might have heard of which would be classed as neurodivergent are things like autism, ADHD, Tourette's, dyslexia, dyspraxia, dyscalculia, dysgraphia, Mears, I never know how to pronounce this one, Mears-Erlen syndrome, hyperlexia, and synesthesia. And there's lots more, and it's okay if you don't know what all of those are, but it's just sort of this awareness that there's lots of different ways of thinking things. And although we tend to assume that there's maybe one good way of doing things, there's actually lots that are all valuable. Just a quick thing before we move forward, everyone has their own preferences on this, but in general, people tend to prefer identity first language in relation to neurodiversity, especially autism. So that would mean that most autistic people prefer to be referred to as an autistic person, not a person with autism. The reason for that is fairly simple. It's just the fact that saying person with autism feels like it's a little bit way of trying to make it seem like it's not really part of the person. But for neurodiversity, a lot of people feel it's really a strong part of their identity and not a negative thing at all. Similarly, people often use the word neurodiverse. That actually refers to the whole spectrum from neurotypical to neurodivergent. So everyone in this room is a neurodiverse community, but an individual person who isn't neurotypical would be considered neurodivergent. It's really easy to get these words wrong, and it's really not a problem if you do, just to give you an idea about what we're talking about today. quick outline for the session. We're going to talk about learning and teaching with neurodivergent students. I'll be talking about that. And Leigh is going to talk to you about some ideas for supporting and working with both neurodivergent staff and students. And then we're going to talk about some things that we've got going on at the University of Glasgow. So let's start with learning and teaching. So as I mentioned, that's my job. I teach on the master's and postgrad certificate and postgrad diploma in academic practice, which is a program that most new lecturers are strongly encouraged to do. And it involves helping people think about their teaching. And I like to say, it helps people try and avoid teaching by habit. So to be able to think about why they want to teach the way they do and not just do things because that's the way they've seen it done in the past. One thing that can really get in the way of this is something called the implied student. So let's take a moment and assume that we're all doing really student-focused teaching. You'll hear that phrase used a lot, student-centered teaching and learning. It's just the idea that when you're teaching, you're not just thinking about what you're doing as the lecturer. So, you know, oh, well, I'll do the talk on smoking or something. You're thinking, well, what will the student be doing? What will they get from that? Which is great and a really positive thing to do. The challenge with it is that, of course, when we do that, we're basing that imagined version of the student in our heads on often a lot of stereotypes or things that are related to power. So we're thinking about the people that we've seen be students or ourselves as students. And often those are people that are not very marginalized. So they're often white, male, non-disabled, neurotypical, cisgendered, upper middle class. There's a lot of different things. But the idea is that this means, and this is not something that anyone should feel blamed for doing, but of course, when we're planning our teaching, we're thinking, okay, well, this is what a student is. And so I think that's probably how they'll react. And so without meaning to, we end up designing teaching that actually sort of favors a certain set of students and actively disadvantages a whole other wide variety of students. So what we really need to do to move forward with inclusive learning and teaching is to reconceptualize that idea of what our student is, and especially what a good student is, because something about neurodiversity is that often neurodivergent people will behave in a way that really isn't expected from neurotypical people. And sometimes that can be construed as disrespectful or bad or mean. And a big first step is trying to think, right, okay, that's really different, but that doesn't necessarily mean that they're trying to be difficult here. So the approach that a lot of places take for trying to make things more inclusive for neurodivergent people and disabled people and in general people with different needs is something that is called the accommodation approach. Usually called that in America. Here you would know it as reasonable adjustments. So that's the idea that as per the Equality Act, we're legally obliged to make reasonable adjustments to make sure that we're not discriminating against people with a protected characteristic, like, for example, disability. And what this means is that in the case of learning, a student would go to disability services, they would give information about whatever diagnosis they have. Disability services would come up with some potential things that could be done differently. That list gets passed on to the lecturer. And that is a really good start. But the problem is that, well, there's quite a lot of problems with that as the only approach, which is that it means a lot of people don't get support, because if you don't have a diagnosis, then it makes things a lot more difficult. There's a lot of reasons that people might not be able to or feel comfortable dealing with disability services. And I know that there's often a lot of demand for that kind of service. There's also people that might not realize they have a condition, they just know things are a bit more difficult. It also singles out learners and it reinforces the idea that there's this problem with the student. So what's the solution? So one way of thinking about a way that we can do things a bit more proactively inclusively is to use the concept of universal design for learning, which really refers to the idea that instead of only responding to specific adjustments that you know that people have requested, you try and proactively design things in a way that allow different ways of engaging with things, so you don't have to fit into this rigid narrow box to be able to engage with the learning. But it's hard to do that if you don't know what these people might be like, what they might find difficult. So it can be quite hard to do that without relying on implied student. And in a way, the only thing you can really do is just to be open to people's experiences, stories, and feedback. And if somebody says, do you know what, that didn't really work for me, to be able to be like, oh, okay. And to have a think about whether you might want to try doing something a bit differently next time. You absolutely do not have to get it perfect. And I think that one of the hardest things about inclusivity is that worry that you'll try and it still won't be good enough. But it's just a great thing to try if it's something that you feel uncomfortable with. I'm aware this is all quite conceptual. I am going to get to some practical things in a moment, I promise. So universal design for learning has three main sort of pillars, and those are the idea that you should provide multiple ways of engagement, representation, and action or expression. So that means that you should have a variety of different ways that people can engage, for example, with content. There should be lots of different people portrayed in the examples that you give, and there should be more than one way for people to participate. Some things that are specific about neurodiversity, about neurodivergent people, that you may or may not be aware of, just to give an example of some of the things that you might not expect. I think we tend to have assumptions that everyone works in a certain way, everyone prefers this, everyone prefers Y. I've certainly heard a lot of statements like that, and they've usually been things that I don't actually find myself. So here's some examples. So some neurodivergent people, and one of them, focus best with a background task to calm their mind. So for me, if I'm working, I kind of need to have music on in the background or a film I've seen a million times, and it enables the rest of my brain to focus on work. Sounds weird, I think, to a lot of people, but it's something that can be really helpful for some. And it's something that you might assume, oh, well, they're not paying attention. They're, you know, they've got music on, they can't do their work properly. But it's an example of a way where actually one can. Some people who are neurodivergent find working in groups actively detrimental to their learning. And I bring this up because I once went to a training course, not here, where somebody said, oh, well, everyone works better in groups. And I disagreed with that very politely, as I'm sure you can imagine. This is not to say that you should never have group work, and it's not to say that I know there are some situations, especially where accreditation is involved, where you absolutely have to have group work. But what I'm suggesting here is that sometimes you think about whether group work is the best example, and there's some really simple tips you can use. Like, for example, rather than saying discuss this with the people at your table, you could just say, okay, I just want you to all take 5 minutes and have a think about it and write down what your notes are. I think that this can be a particular issue when we're talking about active learning, because people assume active learning has to mean group work, and it doesn't. What it has to mean is that the student is actively thinking, but they can do that silently if that's something that works better for them. So we neurodivergent people might understand things differently to what you intended, which is why it's so good to be explicit as much as you can. We might not comply with expected social conventions, and this is true of lots of people. Like, I'm disabled and I usually sit cross-legged. That doesn't mean that I'm trying to be unprofessional or inappropriate. It means that I'm not in pain. There's a lot of examples like that that make sense within a neurodivergent context too. Another one would be using laptops while you're working or learning. That's something that helps me to stay focused, but for a lot of people, they think, well, that doesn't seem very polite. Some people might engage with learning very obviously. So some neurodivergent people, I, for example, am a person that speaks up a lot and really wants to contribute all the time because it's the only way I can keep my brain focused. But that's not really necessarily ideal for all the other learners. Whereas some people might be completely silent, but they're actually learning just as much as that loud, talkative person. And some people might find it hard to process large chunks of text or mathematical information. So it can be good to break those things up and not just provide a document with kind of a wall of text. Here's some other ones which Leigh has contributed, but we thought would fit well in this part of the talk. So might have bursts of energy and then go quiet. That's quite common, especially for people with ADHD. Might need downtime after spending a lot of energy on Zoom in meetings. I think that's something that a lot of us can relate to during the pandemic. Some people might be better at or want written communication rather than spoken communication. And a good example of this, I think, is when I've had situations where people have said, oh, well, I really need to have quite a serious talk with you, but it has to wait 3 weeks, but it should be in person. I don't think this is the kind of thing you would want to do at a distance. And actually, for me, I would much prefer to have it in writing because it gives me time to process it emotionally before I have to respond. Again, that's not to say that you have to do it that way, but it's just keeping in mind that different people have different preferences. Some people can multitask, and some people can only concentrate on one task at a time, and that both are really completely valid. So a few tips. One is that inclusion is a process and not an end point. And honestly, I find it a bit terrifying specializing in this because I am one of those people with a massive fear of getting things wrong. And which is actually a big, quite common part of ADHD. We have something called rejection sensitivity, which means we're particularly emotional about the idea of being told that we're bad or done something wrong. But just starting and being open to it is just a brilliant thing. Second tip is something we touched on and that Leigh will talk a bit more about, which is that many people won't have a diagnosis or even know that they're neurodivergent. They just know that they might know they seem to be experiencing things differently to other people, but often we're conditioned. No, you're just making a fuss, get on with it. And so it might be really difficult for someone to speak up about their needs. So try not to reprimand students for acting differently to what you might expect. I'm sure that you're all really kind people who are here and that you don't do this, but it can just be really harmful to a student to be yelled at if what they're really trying to do is just get their needs met. Try and be as clear and explicit as possible about your expectations. Again, I think this is something people have been having to do more with the online learning due to the pandemic. And try and break things down into chunks, because I think we can all identify with that idea that sometimes if you have a massive task, it can feel really overwhelming to get started. And that can be particularly true for some neurodivergent people. And tip 5 seems to be the same as tip 1. I'm not sure why I got it in twice, so let's move on. But above all, be kind and approachable. And if you're teaching, then letting students know that if there's something that isn't really working for them, then they can get in touch with you is a really good way of signaling that you are open to learning more and that you're not going to give them a hard time. So I'll pass you over to Leigh, and I'm going to be her slide master.
Thank you, Elliott. So in terms of supporting and working with neurodivergent staff and students, what can we do? Next slide, please. As Elliott has mentioned, many people will not have a diagnosis or know that they're neurodivergent. So for instance, in my case, it wasn't until I actually undertook this project, which is quite ironic because I lead a neurodiversity project, that I am neurodivergent and that I have struggled with different things and had different referrals and different medical appointments. But sometimes you don't realize that you are neurodivergent and have diagnosis. So this is why making things as accessible as possible enhances inclusivity and neurodiversity. Next slide, please. And you can do this by harnessing strengths in neurodivergent people. So the first step to harness strengths in neurodivergent people is reflection and observation on your own ideologies in terms of what you deem behavior, communication, and mannerisms to be normal or typical. So your interpretation of how another person behaves or communicates is from your own experiences. And that's fine, because that's how we all base our future exchanges on what we've learned, read, seen in the past. However, this can easily fall down the trap of, but my normal way is the best way, or this doesn't fit in with my perception, or this isn't the perception or the ideologies of the university, so it's invalid. So it's really important to observe your own reactions to others and reflect on your own impact, which leads me to my next point, impact. So if you ever find yourself in a situation where someone has sent maybe a very direct email that you might have found to be rude, or if someone is asking lots of questions over something you think is an easy task, you can ask yourself, well, what else can be happening here? Is there another way of seeing this? What can I do to understand this way of behaving and communicating? And from this reflection, you can actively change your normalized perception of someone else's behavior to acceptance of different behaviors and communication styles. And then lastly is to harness this ambition that exists in others, because this will activate positive change. So the more people who actively change to be inclusive by having like a broadened perception of others, the better the workforce will be. And to also try to make everything as accessible as possible, from meetings, recordings, work materials, access to buildings, etc. Because they'll negate singling anyone out. Next slide, please. So examples of what you can do to allow different mannerisms and communication styles are allowing people to conserve energy. So Elliott's touched upon this, but sort of allowing breaks in between meetings, as some neurodivergent people may have like sensory sensitivity or feel overwhelmed from lots of communication. So allowing that to have breaks. You can allow fidget spinners. So you've probably seen some children, there was a trend not that long back, but it's very helpful to some neurodivergent people. And then you can also allow sort of multitasking inside and outside of meetings to help concentration. Allowing incomplete thoughts. So if a person is in the middle of thinking, allow that person to think. And if you can see that they're struggling, ask them if they would like help instead of taking over the conversation. And the reason being is because if you take over a conversation and someone is just in the middle of thinking, it might feel like their thought isn't valued or their contributions aren't valued, and it might make them more less confident in themselves. Allowing cameras to be switched off for comfort is another one. And then you can ask the person or group of people's communication preference. So communication by email, or do you prefer to have meetings to go over ideas, etc. Handing out slides, meeting notes, agendas in advance of the meeting. So this can help a person prepare for questions. That Elliott's touched upon this too. And announcing your adjustments. So if you have any adjustments, to announce them so that neurodivergent people also know there's a safe space for them to announce theirs too. But most importantly, next slide, please. If a person requires reasonable adjustments, to actively listen to what it is they require, and to empathize with the neurodivergent person. So neurodivergent conditions and general disability conditions, they're still heavily stigmatized. So it takes a lot of courage for that person to have the confidence to ask for reasonable adjustments. So it's important to try and empathize how they might feel in that situation. To accept them as well. If this is what the person needs to carry out their studies or work, that they are the expert of their condition, so they would know. And then to apply it in practice. Next slide, please. And then lastly, just keep in mind that everyone is important and should be appreciated, including yourself. So I'll pass it back over to Elliott to talk about his initiatives.
I have a fidget toy to demonstrate to you all. So there's a variety of initiatives going on at the moment that have really started in the past, year or so? So we are really trying to start having conversations about neurodiversity. And since I've got quite a wide variety of people from around the university here, I think it's a good time to tell. Most of this stuff is stuff that's been sort of scraped together. So if there's anyone that thinks, oh well, I think of a way that this could be supported or resourced centrally, then that is great and very helpful. Thank you. So this first one is central. So I have created and just run a new course on the master's in the MEd in academic practice and PGCAP on inclusive learning and teaching. And we had, I think, 13 students, which is about normal for an optional course on that. And it's gone really well. So I'm very relieved because I was quite nervous about running that for the first time. So this is just as a reminder, a course for new lecturers who are going out and working with students. So I'm hoping that we can get an increasing number of people engaging with all of these issues so that they can cascade that out to the places where they're working and we can have a culture building of inclusivity. Next, my colleague Chiara Horlin and I have founded a neurodiversity network, which includes a Twitter account, which we've got here. It's U of G NeuroDiv, and an MS team, which is to allow a space for people to connect, whether they identify as neurodivergent themselves, they're doing research or work in that area, or they just want to learn more about it. We've run a few events so far, especially in relation to Neurodiversity Celebration Week, which was back in March, I think, last year. So hopefully more coming from that. And a new Neurodiversity Society is just starting as well, which some of the students have initiated. And then Leigh, did you want to just quickly talk about the projects that you're working on, that you're leading?
Yes. So as I said in my introduction, so I'm the lead on the neurodiversity project within MVLS. So basically my role, I just realised I didn't explain that at the start. My role is to promote neurodiversity throughout the university and to support neurodivergent staff. So initially started off creating a group within Institute of Health Sciences, also being part of the Diversity and Inclusion Committee in School of Veterinary Medicine, but now we've taken different initiatives that are going to be released throughout the university, and one of those is creating a neurodiversity resource hub. So that's in progress at the moment and we're hoping to launch it by next year.
Great. So there's some references here from what we've been talking about today, but we've got one question that's come in so far. But the other thing to note is that Manjinder, who I think is the person that has started the Neurodiversity Society, is just about to share a couple of links to information about the Student Society. I think they've been sent just to us, Leigh, but I think going to be shared with everyone. So if anyone is a student and interested in that, then definitely follow that up. So we've got a question that's come in. So I think I'm going to press answer live and see what happens there. Great. Okay. So the question that's come in is, what does one do as a student where you encounter a difficult assignment that's difficult because of lack of clarity around the assignment itself? It can become a sticking point, a point of fixation. The power imbalance causes the voice of the student to not be heard as much as someone who is perhaps not a lecturer. The student engages in a few discussions to seek clarity, still doesn't get it, feels frustrated. The lecturer's advice, just do it. Yeah, I think that is exactly the kind of situation that I am really trying quite hard to request that lecturers stop doing. There are a number of different ways sort of thinking about this. I mean, the challenge is that obviously, ideally, the assignment would be explained in a way that is clear, but it seems like in this case, the lecturers responded in quite an unhelpful way. Obviously, there is a bit of a challenge in that if an assignment is agreed the way that it is on the approval forms, then it can't really be changed without that. But that does not mean that it can't be explained with more clarity. So I'm not sure what the best answer is, apart from to see if there's someone else in the department that would be able to help, like somebody or a student support officer maybe in the department, if there is one, because it does sound like this is the kind of situation where the lecturer is not really understanding where you're coming from. It's put if I'm giving them the best possible intentions. So I think probably the best thing to do in this case would be to discuss the issues with someone else in the department who might be able to help mediate between you and the lecturer. But I have a lot of sympathy because that sounds like a really difficult situation. Let's just see. Leigh, did you want us to discuss the questions that have been submitted via email as well? Or did you want to...
That's fine. Would you mind stop sharing your screen?
I'll do that now. Hopefully people have got a hold of the...
So we had a question in advance because someone couldn't make the live session. So, sorry, I'm just putting it to one side. There we go. Could I ask something related to teaching? I have two practical questions. One issue is during tutorials or seminar discussions, the disability service sends us a list, often a bit late, stating that a few students in our class should not be asked to speak in class small groups, etc. Since this information should be confidential, what kind of adjustments can we make in class when other students are not aware of this sort of problem?
So this really fits in with the whole universal design for learning side of things, which is that ideally making things more flexible is something that could potentially benefit all students. Now, giving too much choice, I know, can be overwhelming as well, so it is a difficult line to draw. But for example, my feeling is that what would be ideal would be to have unless there's really very specific reasons the group work is absolutely necessary. Like, for example, I know that with psychology, for example, it's on the accreditation that they have to do a certain amount of group work. But if that isn't the case, then I would make it optional. I would say you can do this work in groups or you can do it by yourself. And however you choose to facilitate that from a technical perspective is up to you. But I think that's one really simple way of doing it, is just making these things available to everyone. And that way it helps those people that don't have anything formalized as well. And that, honestly, I think the problem with only relying on reasonable adjustments is it gives us this idea that only a subsection of people are really worth or deserve to have their needs met, when in fact everyone deserves to have their needs met. And actually, if we can think about being flexible with people more generally, then it's something that hopefully will help everyone. And the other thing is that having a diagnosis actually involves a huge amount of privilege anyway. Like, people who are marginalized, for example, people of color, trans people, women are less likely to have their medical stuff taken seriously anyway. So actually only using reasonable adjustments sort of further increases that inequity. So that was that question, Leigh. There was another one, wasn't there?
Yes, and the second question is about balance. What would be a reasonable amount of support an individual lecturer should be expected to provide? For example, correcting transcribe on Zoom recording, which can be essential for some disabled students, takes ages. But at this moment, I cannot see much support from the university. Also, when a course has a few students who need different types of support, it is impossible for a single lecturer to handle. Any advice on how the university can support both relevant students and lecturers?
So I think there's sort of two questions here. So I believe that the official position on, which is not, just to be clear, I'm not important enough to be making these decisions, but the official position on time spent doing like amending transcripts and correcting is meant to be 15 minutes per hour. Now, I'm aware that that is not how long it takes. However, this is a situation where I would agree the university does not give enough supports, and perhaps we just all need to make our voices heard on that one, to the people that perhaps do have the potential to make those sorts of decisions. I think that also does link in with what we've got coming in on the chat. So it's just come through to just us, Leigh, but I'll read it out. It's, how can we better support lecturers to be able to provide materials far enough in advance? The only reasonable adjustment I've been asked is to see materials for the whole term in advance, which isn't practical for the lecturer as they haven't written it all yet. But obviously this then impacts the students. Can the university change the workload model for lecturers to accommodate changes they need to make for now and the future? Yeah, I mean, again, I think that's a really brilliant point. And I really, really emotionally relate to the concept of wanting to make it available but it not being written yet, because that's definitely what my position has been this semester as a very overwhelmed person. Again, I think you make, like, I think this is an excellent point in that the university wants to be inclusive, this is what it is saying. However, there are certain things that need to be put in place. And actually, one of the things that's been discussed a lot in the classes I teach on inclusion and on neurodiversity are, I love this, this is great, I have so much workload, I would never be able to do it. And I wish I had an answer, I'm really sorry I don't have an answer, but I think the answer is that we all need to start maybe raising these things as barriers to being able to be more inclusive in the hope that it might make something change. We've got more questions. Currently doing my master's dissertation, which my topic is neurodiversity in the workplace. Do you think the stigma which is attached to neurodiversity or the lack of awareness affects neurodiverse people within any institution, academic or work? Well, I'm sure Leigh will have a position on this as well. I would say yes, because there's two issues really. One is that there's a lot of stigma attached to those labels. So you say you're autistic, people assume that that means something. My partner was diagnosed as autistic when she was 5 and she was basically told that they didn't ever expect her to achieve anything. So that is one side of it, that people hear something when they hear the label. And the other issue is that if people don't know about the label, then they see behaviors and make assumptions those people are being bad or difficult. So asking lots of questions or maybe being quite direct or not wanting to socialize as much. These are all possible things that you might look at and think, oh, well, that person just doesn't care or they're being mean. And in fact, it's just another usually perfectly reasonable way of behaving. Leigh, did you have anything you wanted to add for that one?
Just to echo what you said, and I think it's both, because you asked, is there a stigma attached to neurodiversity? I don't think the stigma is to neurodiversity. I think it's what Elliott said in terms of the conditions, those neurodivergent conditions, and that when we have seen neurodivergent conditions in the media, they're very stereotyped to young white boys. So ADHD, you picture a young child running around. When you picture autism, you think of someone having a sensory overload as a young white boy. So I think there is issues with stigmatism to that. And then when you say and a lack of awareness, yeah. So I think it's hard, because if you are neurodivergent, a lot of the time you have this thing called camouflage and you're trying to fit in to this neurotypical world. So then, especially in institutions and universities, you're trying your best to fit into there. So then you're not sort of accurately representing your neurodivergent condition, because people see you perhaps as the same as everyone else. So I think it's a lack of representation too, which then affects the stigmatism of neurodivergent conditions. So it's a bit of both.
And actually, even building on that, the kind of other thing is that some clinicians have an assumption that if you're successful, then you couldn't possibly have these conditions. I have multiple friends that have been told they couldn't possibly be ADHD because they got a PhD or they got a degree or they were good in school. And we probably don't have enough time to go into this in detail today, but there's a lot of different ways that, for example, autism, ADHD, Tourette's, dyslexia, etc., all manifest, and they all depend on the way that you find to cope. And so, especially if you have the non-stereotypical young white boy version, which is oversimplifying, of course, that's not to say that it's a different experience. It's just saying that we all kind of manifest and cope in different ways. So yes, massively. Mm-hmm. All right, so I've got one from we're not reading our names, are we? We've got one which I think is a really good idea. So it says, in terms of producing work, especially writing, templates and exemplars can be very helpful in terms of learning and teaching and in terms of working as staff. For example, for student dissertations, previous students' work, if appropriate and with permissions, can be helpful to see. Sometimes the request can come across as if one is lacking ideas when it may be the opposite, that many different options and structures are coming to mind when exemplar and template can make things clearer. I actually think that's an amazing point that you've made there. I am someone that definitely would benefit from that. And I think that a lot of people are like, well, that's cheating. And I think the problem is, as the person setting the piece of work, you probably have something in your mind, like a mental picture of what it's going to look like. And transmitting that mental picture to other people could be extremely difficult. And so often I've heard people say, oh, well, yeah, I suppose they answered the question, but it wasn't what I really meant. And that's an example of where clearly the communication hasn't been clear enough. And one way to get across that communication really clearly is to use a template or exemplar. And it's something I'm currently considering with some of my own courses. So I'm really glad that you've raised that. But just to reinforce, absolutely, that doesn't mean the person doesn't have ideas. It means that they're trying to figure out what your expectations are. And especially if you're neurodivergent, you're quite used to your behavior, your default being different to what other people expect from you. And so trying to avoid getting it wrong in that case is quite an understandable thing to do. Here we've got an idea. Staff time could be built into workload models. Ideally, the university would have a consistent approach to this rather than schools, research institutes having to do their own thing. Yeah, I agree. I mean, I don't know what it's like. Every person in higher education I've spoken to in the past year is absolutely pushed beyond their limits. And you know, teaching inclusively is one of many, many areas in which I think people are very much overloaded at the moment. But I agree with you that moving forward, I think there does need to be consideration of, like, if we're going to teach inclusively, which I think we should, how do we build that in consistently in a way that people are given that time? And it's not just, because what I really don't want to happen is what it ends up is that individual conscientious lecturers end up working out with the amount of hours they really should be working because they care so much. And I understand that is probably what is happening. But if you need a central person to tell you this, let it be me. Please prioritize your own health, well-being, mental health. If you can't implement anything new in your teaching because it will make you unwell or it will involve working more than you are being paid to work, I think your own personal boundaries are more important in that case.
Mm-hmm. I'd also like to note that Elliott, Laura McNaughton and Sophie Mason, we have created a Moodle template. So not sure if that would add to workload or hopefully help, but that could be something. It basically has all the templates there and you just fill in the blanks. So that might be useful for people teaching.
Does the university have a role model who's neurodivergent? I mean, just look at me, Kate. I mean, I'm right here. No, I know that in the vet school, they have a neurodiversity champion, but which is Peter Hasty, which is really nice. I don't think we actually have that in other parts of the university. You're right, though. It's a good thing. It's a good idea. I'm just having a look. The template that Leigh mentioned is something that's freely available. Just it's a sort of an example course that we've built to try and make it as inclusivity and neurodiversity friendly as possible. So we hope that that will be useful for people. So we've also got having to constantly state a diagnosis is also super tiring, as often the person then has to explain things over and over. How can the university help with this? Well, I agree with you completely. And I think the university is actually working on something like this for the moment. I mean, it is particularly in relation to agreed reasonable adjustments, but I think the university is working on a reasonable adjustment passport for staff at least, which would involve just there being a document that could be disseminated, I assume with your permission, to people that needed to know, so that you would hopefully not have to go over things as many times. I do know what you mean, though. It does feel like sometimes like being constantly in a battle, because it's a bit like being trans, actually, in a way, in that you know that having to tell people about it means that people might respond badly to you. So you're constantly waiting for someone to kind of have something negative to say about it. And especially with neurodiversity, like that can be a real exhausting thing when you might already be exhausted from all of the communication. Peter is very nice, this is true.
I'd also like to note as well that you don't have to state your, it's up to you, and obviously you already know all this anyway, the person's specifying this, but you could just state your adjustments. You don't have to explain what your condition is. You could just say, this is what I require, can I have this, please? You know, that's all you need to say. And that's why I wanted to make the point of announcing adjustments, so that it becomes sort of normalized. And I know that, like Elliott has said, they are going to start doing reasonable adjustment things within quality diversity unit and HR, but that's not for us to comment on, really. But yeah, so keep your eyes peeled for that, but you don't need to specify your condition over and over. It's your decision.
So it looks like that's been a very helpful comment from you, Leigh, according to the chat. So I'm really glad that you brought that up about being able to just state the adjustments. Like, you absolutely do not need to disclose your conditions to anyone, actually. I think possibly occupational health when you're getting it sorted, but you know, I tend to be very open about mine because that's my personal preference. And I guess because I work in this kind of job, I like to be visible in that way, but it's absolutely nobody's should ever feel pressured into doing that. So there's another one about online learning, which is one that I personally have a lot of feelings about. So online learning was excellent and is dyslexic friendly, especially when the lectures are pre-recorded. You can go back and listen, which I hope will remain on Moodle. Note-taking in lectures has affected my learning. Yeah, I super agree. So I know that for a lot of people, online learning has been really bad, and including some people from a neurodiversity perspective. For me, it's been amazing. It means that I can work at my own pace. I can self-regulate. I can fidget with things, doodle and stuff without anyone shooting me mean looks. I'm not talking about anyone on my team. My team, luckily, are extremely delightful. Being able to, I know some people find this a bit weird, but being able to watch recordings at a faster pace is incredible, because I have many personal flaws, but one thing I can do is process information quite quickly sometimes. So for me, listening to a slow lecture is actually quite emotionally painful. So there's been so many things. And also, the other thing that I like to say is that it's changed all the defaults. So we had all these assumptions about how learning should happen. There's some air quotes there for anyone just listening. But we've been forced to make different decisions because of the pandemic. And we've also been forced to say, I just lost it because I saw something interesting come in on the chat and now my brain's gone. Oh yeah, we've been forced to be more explicit with people. And we've been forced to think, what are we actually trying to achieve with our teaching here? Like, I did a 3-hour lecture on X. What was I trying to get out of it? So no, don't apologize for the question there. It's a good one. How is the university? The thing is, I don't know how the university is approaching things, I'm afraid, but I can tell you what I think. How is the university approaching long COVID brain fog, given that this might be a temporary or longer term issue for some? Well, let me tell you, as somebody who already had disabilities that were basically very, very similar to a lot of long COVID stuff, which long COVID made worse for me, I don't know what the university is doing specifically, but I do think that in general in society, we don't do a great job of acknowledging those things or supporting those things, either from, yep, chronic fatigue. Sorry, it's coming up in the chat for those of you not seeing that. So I have fibromyalgia, I have hypermobility spectrum disorder, I have dysautonomia, I have sleep disorder. So yes, so it's very relevant for those with chronic fatigue, ME, fibromyalgia, any of those things. Which I only managed to get diagnoses for by going private mostly. Again, there's just so many issues with getting that. So I hope the university will be supportive. But I don't know what I don't know what the position is essentially. I'm sure the position is they want to be supportive. However, if anyone does want to have a discussion about long COVIDs or COVID brain fog and related conditions and what they think would be useful, I'd be very happy to talk to people about it. I'm not personally someone that's going to be in charge of those changes, but I can certainly bring the issues to the people that can. So yes, I'll put my email address in the chat for anyone that does want to get in touch about that. Again, I'm not saying I have a solution, but it is a good point that you've raised. Yeah, it's complicated. Telling students to take a year off, for example, it's very complicated, and I think it reflects how little certain processes. I'm autistic and I'm trying to be polite and I'm struggling to say things in a way that doesn't make it sound like I'm trying to implicate the university in things. I'm just saying we're currently, I don't think, really great in general in this country at supporting people with chronic illness. And I think that long COVID is really bringing that to the surface, and hopefully it will be a catalyst for making things better. Yeah, I mean, a great point's been raised here that when it comes to neurodiversity, disability, etc., it can really, really rely on like your line manager or supervisor or tutor, in that if you have someone that is not supportive, then sometimes it can feel like there isn't really a safety net. You know, it's like, well, just the line manager will deal with it. Well, what if the line manager is abusive, is a bully? People sometimes talk, oh, well, maybe they're just not educated. Maybe they just need to be told. Or maybe they are a bully and they're intentionally not doing this. You know, that's a challenge, I think. I can imagine that quite a lot of people now are thinking, oh no, I really hope I don't come across like that. I'm sure you don't come across like that. My experience of it have been quite obvious. So I'm so sorry, there's building work going on. Leigh, do you have anything to say about that?
I was just going to say that being part of a union is very helpful in cases like that. So UCU, and I know that that's one of the unions you could join, and you'd have your own personalised casework and they would support you through that. So if you are having trouble, it's, you know, it's obviously not ideal going through that and sort of having to relive different experiences that you might have experienced, but that is one option. Also, as well, it's up to you, again, depending on how comfortable you feel, but going to HR directly might be helpful too. I did have a thought and it's gone. No, it's gone. Oh, I hate it when that happens.
I know, me too. So it seems a lot of drilling is starting outside of my window. So I'm going to say goodbye. I'm just going to say thank you so much, everyone. And so, because this noise is really probably going to upset a lot of people. I'm really glad for people saying this is helpful. If anyone wants to get in touch, either to give feedback or to chat about any of this, then please just pop either of us an email. We're friendly people. So it's been really, really lovely speaking to you all. And Leigh, can you remind people where the recordings will be made available?
Yeah, thank you so much, Elliott. Yeah, I can take the questions afterwards as well, so I will answer them if you have to leave as well, Elliott. And recordings are all going to be sent at a later date, so I have to go through, make sure that the transcribe matches up with what we're saying, which takes a bit of time, but they will be sent to all attendees. So thanks again, Elliott. I'm just going to go through the chat box now.
I don't need to disappear quite yet. I just don't want people to have to listen to the drilling, especially since this is a session about sensory stuff.
Yeah, of course. So that's the talks. I filled out the occupational health referral form with my line manager, which helped us discuss everything clearly. But I know this isn't for everyone. Yeah, that is one route that you can go down. Amazing. Thank you, Elliott. Starting a PhD with fibro and CFS currently, and it's a tricky one to navigate. Having discussions surrounding chronic health issues gets complex quite quickly. I have to leave now. Just thank you so much for the talk. It was helpful. Thanks a lot. Thanks. La, 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 la. Going through. Someone's put like a little emoji. Thanks both. Yep, I'm just going through. Right, that's fine. Yeah. Okay, great. If anyone does have any questions, just let us know. Here's my email too. I'm just going to pop that in the chat as well, but people most probably have it if you've signed up to the talk. But I will just pop it in just in case. There we go. Someone has said, as they probably know, occupational health is supportive but can't really help with the diagnosis. Yeah, that is true. In a lot of cases, you do have to have a diagnosis in order to get reasonable adjustments. So it is a tricky process to have. So I think that's why we're talking about accessibility in the first instance, so that people who are undiagnosed, or if there is a miscommunication or people don't understand a condition, then that's sort of accessible to them.
So, Mandinder, I'm not quite sure what your question, so you said what can be done for cross-department collaboration when it comes to working with ND support, neurodivergent support. I know some are more supportive than others. I'm not sure what you're actually asking. I mean, I'm guessing you might have something quite specific in mind, because, like, yes, it's a great idea that departments work together and learn from each other. I guess there has to be someone in the departments willing to do that. I would hope that there would be. I guess probably the trick is to find the people that are supportive within each department and try and get them to influence the rest of the department. Okay, my cat has come to say hello.
So that's 2 p.m. now. I just want to I just made something quickly just to thank some people who've really helped me with this. So I would just like to thank Dr. Lydia Batch for all of her efforts in regards to the Chancellor's Fund. Without her, we wouldn't have been granted the funding for these talks. I'd also like to thank Suzanne Hendry for helping me with paying the speakers, and Janelle Kelly for her guidance on advertising Zoom webinars and Eventbrite. Lastly, I'd like to thank the speakers for taking time out of their schedules to provide us with these amazing talks. And to the attendees for also taking the time out of your busy schedules to learn more about neurodiversity and disability inclusive practices. So thank you again.